Good morning, Mahendra. Myself, Deepasa, assistant professor from ECE department. And today I am here to explain the concept of pulse code modulation. Right? So before we move on to pulse code modulation, let us see the classification of the different modulation schemes. Right? So basically, so there are three different modulation schemes. One is the continuous wave modulation scheme, and the second one is the pulse modulation schemes, and the third one is digital modulation schemes. Right? So in continuous wave modulation schemes, there are again two types of schemes. So one is the amplitude modulation scheme and the angle modulation scheme. So in amplitude modulation, so we have the conjunction amplitude modulation AM, and the second one is the double sideband suppressed carrier, and the third one is single sideband suppressed carrier, and the fourth one is vestigial sideband modulation. These are the four types, so which comes under the category of amplitude modulation. Right? Now coming to the angle modulation, there are two types. So one is the frequency modulation. So generally we denote it as like FM. And the second one is the phase modulation. So we denote it as PM. So coming to the pulse modulation schemes. So there are again two types: pulse analog modulation scheme, and the second one is pulse digital modulation schemes. Right. So the examples of the pulse analog modulation schemes are, so the first one is pulse amplitude modulation scheme, the second one is pulse width modulation, and which is also known as pulse duration modulation scheme, and the third one is pulse position modulation. Right. Now, so coming to the pulse digital modulation schemes, so the first one is pulse code modulation, and the second one is differential pulse code modulation, so which is generally known as DPCM. And coming to the third one, delta modulation, and the fourth one is the adaptive delta modulation. So these are the four varieties which comes under the category of pulse digital modulation schemes. And under pulse analog modulation schemes, so we have three types: pulse amplitude, pulse width, and pulse position. And similarly, in digital modulation schemes, so there are again two types. So one is the binary modulation scheme, and the second category is MRI modulation schemes. Right? So for MRI, we have the M equals to 2 power n. So where m represents the number of signals that are going to transmit, and the small m represents number of bits per each signal. Right? So in binary, we have again four types. One is the binary amplitude shift keying, BASK, and the second one is binary phase shift keying, and the third one is binary frequency shift keying. So there is one more variety, what is DPSK. So differentially encoded phase shift keying, which is a non-covariant version of BPSK. So coming to the MRI, so depends upon your n value, m will take different values. For example, if you take n equals to 2, your m will become 4, so 4 is nothing but quad. Right? So quad, we have quadrature BSK, quadrature PSK, and quadrature FSK. And similarly, if your n is 3, then m will take 2 power 3, which is equal to 8, then you will have 8 PSK, 8 PSK, and 8 FSK. And similarly, if n equals to 4, so on, so depending upon your n value, you will have different MRI modulation schemes. And for binary, so it is the default version of MRI, where n equals to 1, so when n equals to 1, your m will take the value of 2. So 2 nothing but binary. So that's why we call it as binary. So it's also binary, but it's differentially encoded, right? So this is the basic classification of different modulation schemes, right? So now today I'm going to talk about this one. So the pulse code modulation. So this is the initial modulation scheme under this category. And after that, so since it has few disadvantages, so they have modified this PCM and they call it as differential PCM. Again, differential PCM, again it has few drawbacks, and those drawbacks are overcome by a slight modification. So that modified version is called a delta modulation. Again, this delta modulation again has drawbacks. So those drawbacks are eliminated, and the modified version is called as an adaptive delta modulation. So now we are going to discuss about this PCM first. So what is PCM? What are the different drops that are available in PCM? And what are their functionality? So the components that we need, that's the first one is your information source, and the second one is the sample and hold circuit. I can say simple, the sample circuit, and the third one is the quantizer, and the fourth one is your source encoder, and fifth one is the channel encoder. So these are the components that we require at the transmitting side, and at the receiving side. So let us say sixth one. So it's a reverse case. So it's like the channel decoder we need, and the second one source decoder, and the last one is the low pass filter and the distillation. So in between the transmitter and receiver, obviously we need a channel. So you can say here it is a channel, right? So to put all this together, so we'll get a block diagram. So what is the first one? So the first one is your information source, followed by the sample circuit and the next one is your quantizer, and followed by the source encoder and the last one is the channel encoder. This is source encoder. And in between we have the channel. And coming to the receiving section, as I said, the first component in the receiving section is the channel decoder. And the source decoder. And we need a low pass filter. So then the destination. Right? So these are the components that we require to set up a basic PCM circuit. So let us start with the information source. So basically the information source is going to produce the analog signal, which is continuous in the time and as well as the amplitude. Right? So let us represent the signal with x of t. Right? So source is going to produce a continuous time signal, so which is continuous in both time and amplitude. Right? So this signal will be given in a sampler. So sampler is provided with a clock with t seconds. So it means Battery is the second, the sangha is going to produce the sangha. Right? So this signal will be the sangha, and the sangha version of the signal will contain the sangha, and these sangha are going to occur at every DA second. So starting at 0, so at first 1 TS will get 1 sangha, so next is 2 TS, 3 TS, 4, 5, 6, so on. At every TS second, the sangha and whole circuit is going to produce a sangha. Right now, so this sampled version a signal, I can say the time is discretized. So I can say the time of this output signal is discrete time, but whether the amplitude I can say it is continuous, because the amplitude can take any value from V max to V minimum. Therefore, we can say the amplitude of the sampled version of the signal is continuous. So it is not discrete. It is a continuous, because it is going to take all the values from V max, so V minimum to V max. Right? Now, so this sampled version of the signal, let us say X S of T. So X of T is your signal, input signal. S stands for the sampled version of your input signal X of T. Let the sampled version of your signal X of T, so will be given as an input for the quantizer. So basically, the quantizer, the functionality of the quantizer is to round off the sample values to its nearest quantization levels. So in other words, so we'll be transforming the infinite set of values to a finite set of values. So that functionality will be done by the quantizer. So basically, there are different kind of quantizers which are available. So the examples are, so uniform quantizer, non-uniform quantizer. So the output of the quantizer is again the sampled values, but whose values or whose amplitude levels are adjusted to the nearest quantization levels. So again, going to get the samples, the same samples, but whose amplitude values will be adjusted so that the infinite set of the amplitude values will become a finite set, so that the time is discrete and the amplitude will also become discrete, because the amplitude is not going to take with infinite values. So here, the output of the quantizer, at the output of the quantizer, your amplitude will take only a finite set of values. Those finite set of values are known as the quantization levels. Right? So this is T and this is your amplitude. And let us say this is origin. So let us imagine this is the quantized value of your input signal X of T. Right? So now, when you supply these values, these discrete values, you can say discrete values, to the source encoder, now the source encoder is going to represent each sample value with a pixel length of n. So it depends upon the source encoder. If your source encoder is a pixel length source encoder, each discrete quantity or each discrete value will be represented with n bits, if it is a pixel length. But if it is a variable length source encoder, depends upon the probability of occurrence of each discrete value. So the value of n is going to be varied. If the probability of occurrence is more, then the particular discrete value or a sampled value is going to be represented with less number of digits. But if a sample has less probability of occurrence, let us say 1 out of 100, 1 out of 1000, 1 out of 10,000, then that particular sample will be represented with more number of bits. So in that way, the source encoder is going to work. Now, the output of the source encoder, I can say, is a binary bit. So depends upon your source encoder. So the output is a binary bit. I can say the output is a binary data. Right? Now, so this binary data will be given as an input for the channel encoder. So the main purpose of the channel encoder in this setup is to incorporate the error detection and error correction capabilities into the system. Right? So basically, this channel encoder is going to add some extra bits to your binary data, and those extra bits are known as a parity bits. Parity bits, or sometimes called as check bits. Right? So this parity bits and check bits does not convey any information. The main purpose of this parity or check bits is to find whether the receivable data contains errors or not. So that is the main purpose of this file bits. Right? Now this channel encoder will add the extra bits to the binary data, then this data will be transmitted through the channel. So the channel will be a wide or wireless. Right? Now, so this is regarding the transmitting side. So coming to the receiving section, the first block in the receiving section is the channel decoder. Right? So since the channel encoder is adding some extra bits which does not convey any information, so those bits will be removed by the channel decoder. So now the priority bits will be removed from your incoming data. This will be removed and depends upon the channel decoder. So sometimes the channel decoder will perform the error correction also. So as I said, the importance of the priority bits is to check whether the receiver data contains any errors or not. Right? So once the error is found, let us say the error is found, so sometimes the channel decoder itself is going to correct the bits. Right? So once this priority bit is eliminated, so here you will get your binary data. So the output of the channel decoder is your transmitted data. And this binary bits again will be converted into the corresponding display quantities by using the source decoder. So the output of the source decoder is your display quantities, or I can say is the samples. Right? Now, so those samples will be passed to a low pass filter to get back with the original continuous time signal. Right? So once you have your original continuous time signal, so this will be given to the respective destination. So these are the blocks which we need to set up or to design a pulse code modulation. Right? Now, so what is the main disadvantage of this one? So the main advantage of this one is, so the circuit is simple and it's easy to design. Right? But coming to the disadvantages, so there are mainly two disadvantages with this circuitry. So one is the bandwidth that we need, bandwidth requirement. So the required bandwidth is more. So the formula of the bandwidth which is required for PCI system is equals to, so it is the bit rate I can say, so which is equals to n times fs. Right? So fs is the number of samples per second. Fs is the number of samples per second and each sample will be represented with n bits. So the bit rate is bits per second. The value of bits per second is NFS and the value which is required for the PCM is NFS hedge. Right? So this much of the bandwidth is required for transmitting the data through the PCM. Right? So which is more, and coming to the second disadvantage, so data redundancy. The second disadvantage is data redundancy. Right? So in practice, most of the signals have the highly correlated samples. So when you are trying to transmit those highly correlated samples through a PCM system, so the output is duplication data. So every time you have to transmit the same information, so maximum there is only a slight different data. Right? So when the signal is having redundancy data, so then this PCM is not suitable. Therefore, we will be moving to another PCM circuitry. So that is a differential PCM. So which is the next version of PCM, right? So DPCM. So it is a PCM, but the input to the PCM circuitry is always the difference between the successive samples. So by taking the difference between the two successive samples, if any redundancy data is there, that will be removed. Only the new content in the current sample will be transmitted by using the DPCM. So in that way, the redundancy problem will be eliminated. Right? So thank you very much. So we will be discussing the continuation topic in the next session. Thank you.